Salut, c'est Géraldine. Let's play together today. These are not normal times, so I thought I would do something different for you today. We're going to explore some trivia about French language and French culture. You will learn French expressions and French slang, lots of little things about the culture that everybody knows, and a bit of extra customs that most French people apply in real life even without thinking about it. So this is very useful if you're stuck at home and you're watching French movies, or you're listening to podcasts, you're reading French maybe, or you want to improve your French while being confined at home. So grab a pen and a paper and let's try to answer these questions together, and maybe you can answer them before I give the answer. So, I'm going to show you that on my screen. C'est parti! The first question is, how do you say the straw that broke the camel's back in French? You have this idea in French of lots of droplets of water that are going to overwhelm something just because they're adding one to each other. We use water here in French. How do you say the straw that broke the camel's back? In French, we would say, c'est la goutte d'eau qui fait déborder le vase. C'est la goutte d'eau qui fait déborder le vase. So you can imagine more and more water being added, and then one droplet makes everything overflow. One drop of water makes just everything overflow. C'est la goutte d'eau qui fait déborder le vase. Question number two. À table, comment appelle-t-on les trois couverts principaux? À table, comment appelle-t-on les trois couverts principaux? At the table, how do you call the three main pieces of cutlery? It is la fourchette, le couteau and la cuillère. La fourchette, le couteau and la cuillère. If you are used to very high-end restaurants in France, you might have noticed that we have more than that. For example, we have la fourchette à escargot, we also have le couteau à poisson, and we have la cuillère à soupe. So it's just a bit more than just the fork, the knife and the spoon. We have la fourchette à escargot, which is the fork for the snails. Yes, it is. Le couteau à poisson, that's the special knife for the fish, and la cuillère à soupe, that's the spoon for the soup, which is the bigger spoon. By the way, if you love this kind of trivia, all these questions are taken from things that you can learn from my program called Exercise Your French. It's a program that I'm very proud of because it's fun and it covers lots of different stuff, from French conversation to French history to customs, and it's full of quizzes. That's why it has its name. And you can take it with your whole family because it has different sections with different levels: beginner, intermediate, advanced. At the beginning, I give lectures at a more articulate speed. And then for the advanced students, it's more at a normal pace speed, so you can improve your oral comprehension and learn things. So if you're watching this on YouTube and you are not a subscriber to my newsletter, check out this page. You're going to get 100 euro discount when it reopens, plus extra bonuses, so don't miss out on that, because very often students just watching on YouTube miss out on lots of fantastic things that are offered on Commune Française. So check out this page. Question number three. Quel petit pain fourré aux pommes peut-on acheter dans une boulangerie? Quel petit pain fourré aux pommes peut-on acheter dans une boulangerie? What's the name of this little pastry that you can buy in une boulangerie? It has apple in it. It's named like a slipper. It is un chausson. Un chausson is a slipper aux pommes. So, un chausson aux pommes is this delicious viennoiserie that you can buy in une boulangerie. Really, really good. Question 4. Qu'est-ce qu'on doit payer en partant du restaurant? It's the bill, that's easy. But how do you say that in French? We call this la note or l'addition. La note or l'addition, okay? And if you are in France, maybe soon, hopefully, you could check out le plat du jour in restaurants. Le plat du jour is the meal of the day and it's fresh made the same day. Le plat du jour. Question 5 is about customs. So, un ami vous invite chez lui pour 20 heures, à quelle heure est-ce que vous devez arriver? Un ami vous invite chez lui pour 20 heures, à quelle heure vous devez arriver? What do you think? A friend invites you at 8, what time should you be there? It is 20h15, not 8, because in France we have le quart d'heure de politesse, which is the 15 minutes you give to your host to be late so he can finish preparing and you're not early and just putting him in front of his failure of being on time, which is actually the reason. But it's a way for everybody to save face, you say that, and actually to be respectful of each other. So that's le quart d'heure de politesse. So this is why in France, when you are invited to a party, this does not apply to a medical appointment, okay, or a job, anything like that, just with friends. Don't be on time, please, because no one is ready at the time they said. That is le quart d'heure de politesse. Question 6 is about slang. Comment peut-on dire manger en français familier? How do you say to eat in French slang? We have bouffer, that you might know, which is really bad. Ugh, I don't like this word. Grailler, which is a bit better. We have casser la graine. You might know casser la croûte as well. Casser la croûte, you might know this one. And we have boulotter as well. Boulotter. So bouffer is really not good. I don't like it. Grailler a bit better, but not great. Casser la graine and casser la croûte are okay. It's slang. And boulotter is more familiar French. My partner uses that. I use it. It's okay. It's not vulgar at all. It's just everyday French. And this makes your French more fluent. And that's good. Because you don't want to speak like a textbook. No. A little bit of literature now. Qui est la sorcière de la rue Mouffetard? Qui est la sorcière de la rue Mouffetard? Who is the witch of la rue Mouffetard? La sorcière de la rue Mouffetard est une fée dans un conte de fées français. Un conte de fées is a fairy tale written by Pierre Gripari. Okay, this is a modern fairy tale. So you will see a bit of technology and modern children. Un conte de fées. La sorcière de la rue Mouffetard is a witch of the novel of the same name. It is for children, but adults are welcome to read it as well. And the witch wants to eat children who are living in her neighborhood. And who knows what's going to happen? I'm not going to spoil you, but you can check it out at the moment if you have time to read. Un conte de fées is a fairy tale, and this one is written by Pierre Gripari. More literature now. Quelle est la morale de la fable Le Corbeau et le Renard? Quelle est la morale de la fable Le Corbeau et le Renard? Do you know this fable? It is The Crow and the Fox. I'm going to copy-paste it here because it's really big. And again, everybody knows that here. Tout flatteur vit aux dépens de celui qui l'écoute. Tout flatteur vit aux dépens de celui qui l'écoute. That means that anyone who offers flattery to someone else depends on them to leave, actually. That means that you have to be careful when someone gives too much praises of you because they want something from you, okay? What do you remember the fox wants? The fox wants a cheese, un fromage. Do you remember this fable? You might not know it. La fable is about a crow who has a cheese and the fox wants the cheese. How does he do to get the cheese? He makes the crow speak by saying praises about him. Oh, you're beautiful, you're great, you're so clever. So the crow starts to speak because he's flattered by the fox, and at some point the crow's cheese falls down and the fox gets it. So the fox is very, very clever, and it's all about not taking too many praises as true and being careful with who is saying it to you because they want something from you. And it is one of Les Fables de la Fontaine. And do you know who that is? It is Jean de la Fontaine. Jean de la Fontaine wrote this fable and they're very, very, very famous in France. And now a question for the history fans out there. Qui était le chef du Second Empire? Qui était le chef du Second Empire? That's Napoléon III. And he's the nephew of Napoléon III. Napoléon III, if you remember, it's 1852. And he transformed Paris. He hired Haussmann to make these beautiful buildings in Paris. And all the Paris that you might love now, that looks all the time, is from him and from this period. Les immeubles d'Haussmann, and we also have l'Opéra Garnier. Okay, this beautiful opera in the center of Paris is l'Opéra Garnier, and this is from this period as well. So Napoléon III, it was under him that all these things happened in Paris. And now a cultural and geography question. Dans quelle région se trouve le Mont Saint-Michel? Ah, you have to know that. That's la Normandie, I'm sure you know. La Normandie, and this is where you had the Vikings, where you have le camembert is produced there, you have le débarquement, this is where you will go if you want to see the beaches, that where you had le débarquement, D-Day, le débarquement, and it's next to la Bretagne, but don't mix them, okay, because people hate that. La Normandie is where you have le Mont-Saint-Michel, le camembert and le débarquement, and it's next to la Bretagne, beautiful Brittany as well. La Bretagne, don't mix them, people don't like that. Now, for all the people who lived in France or travel to France often, c'est quoi les soldes? C'est quoi les soldes? C'est la période où les magasins baissent leur prix. It is the time where you have discounts in the shops, and this is by law, okay? They can't just do that anytime. It's more flexible now, but it's a very famous period. Well, actually, there are two of those. You have les soldes d'été and les soldes d'hiver. So you have the summer discounts and the winter discounts. That's les soldes. Les soldes. Question 12. Comment s'appelle le fait de parler alors que quelqu'un n'a pas encore fini sa phrase? Comment s'appelle le fait de parler alors que quelqu'un n'a pas encore fini sa phrase? How do you call the fact to cut someone's speech even though they haven't finished speaking? We say couper la parole. Literally to cut the speech. Don't do it. Couper la parole. Question 13 for all those who love theater and concerts and shows. Qu'est-ce qu'on peut dire à quelqu'un qui va monter sur scène pour lui souhaiter bonne chance? You know, we say merde. So you can guess what that means in English. But this is not vulgar, it's just the way we wish good luck. It is what we call un porte-bonheur. But it is also un gros mot. Okay, it's a swearing word, so be careful when you use it. But this is what you will hear when people are going to step on stage. Merde. A question for children and all about culture. Qui vient prendre les dents tombées des enfants la nuit? Qui vient prendre les dents tombées des enfants la nuit? It's not the tooth fairy. No, it's not the tooth fairy. It is la petite souris. In France and in other cultures, it is the little mouse who comes and takes the tooth. And she puts instead une pièce de monnaie. This is cute facts. I love teaching that. La petite souris gets the teeth and she puts une pièce de monnaie in exchange under the pillow. Easy question, very useful at the moment. Quel est le numéro d'urgence qu'on peut appeler en France pour avoir des médecins ou une ambulance? Quel est le numéro d'urgence qu'on peut appeler en France pour avoir des médecins ou une ambulance? What number should you use to call emergency to get an ambulance or the help of a doctor? Do you know? It's 15. We call it le 15. And you call le SAMU. Okay? Le SAMU, it is le 15. And they will send you an ambulance or at least some help to know if you need what kind of help you need. Very, very important number to know. Question 16. Quelle est la phrase habituelle pour demander des nouvelles à un ami? Quelle est la phrase habituelle pour demander des nouvelles à un ami? We say, quoi de neuf? Quoi de neuf? Quoi de neuf? Literally, what's new? You can also say, ça va? How are you? And this is the chit-chat. So, chit-chat is le bavardage. And the verb is bavarder. Okay, to chit-chat. And it's also a way for you, if you don't know the people, to actually start getting in touch and to break. In French, we say briser la glace. Question 17. Quel chanteur français a écrit les chansons Je te donne, Bonne idée ou Là-bas? Quel chanteur français a écrit les chansons Je te donne, Bonne idée ou Là-bas? You have to know him. Because he's so famous in France. Jean-Jacques Goldman, without a big D. Oh. Jean-Jacques Goldman, he's extremely famous in France. And he's not very famous abroad, but he's one of the singers in France and a writer as well. So check him out. Everybody in France know him. They might not like him, that's fine. But everybody know him and his songs as well. Question 18 that you have to know if you've been following Comme une Française for a while, because I did a lesson on that 2 weeks ago. Quelle phrase paraît être un compliment mais est en fait une insulte? Quelle phrase paraît être un compliment mais est en fait une insulte? C'est une erreur de base si tu apprends le français. It's a very fundamental mistake if you're learning French. Well, it's bien fait, and you have to know that. Bien fait, it is often a bad translation for well done, but used alone, it is an insult that means something bad happened to you and you deserved it. So if you want to say well done, you can say bon travail. If it's homework, for example, you can say j'aime beaucoup if it's something you really like. You can say c'est super if you want to say that's great. You can say bien joué if you want to say something was well done, but not homework, just a good idea, for example. Not bien fait. You can say bon travail for homework. J'aime beaucoup. I like this very much. C'est super. That's great. Bien joué as well. There are lots of options, but please do not use bien fait alone to mean well done. That's a very common mistake. Question 19 about families. Comment appelle-t-on le frère et la sœur de son père? Comment appelle-t-on le frère et la sœur de son père? How do you call the brother and the sister of your father? We say son oncle. So you can say mon oncle. And sa tante. So if it's about yours, you can say mon oncle et ma tante. My uncle and my aunt. Mon oncle, ma tante. By the way, if you want to say the new wife of your father, it is la belle-mère. Okay, la belle-mère. And if you want to say your mother-in-law, it is the same. It is la belle-mère as well. La belle-mère is both of those. So yeah, it's tricky when you want to exactly know who you're talking about. So very often, French people are going to precise whom they're talking about. Because la belle-mère can be the new wife of your dad and she can also be your mother-in-law. It's the same word. And question 20. We are there. Congratulations. Quand on ne vient pas à un rendez-vous, quel animal apparaît en français? It is a rabbit, un lapin. Because not going to a meeting is called poser un lapin. Especially when you don't say you're not coming. Poser un lapin. Congratulations! Ta-da! And we are done. Congratulations! How many did you guess? And if you want to go beyond this little quiz about French culture and French language, you have to check out the playlist that I made for you. You will find some bloopers that we gathered along the years, so where I struggle with doing these lessons for you, more French jokes and French expressions, and at last an interactive exercise for you if you want to improve your oral comprehension and written French. So check out this playlist. I will see you in the next video. À tout de suite!